there's coffee over there. I'm gonna grab a cup of coffee at any time. I won't take the time this morning. I'll get a cup of coffee. Kim is also recording it tonight. And hi to everyone over there on the other end. Regarding Facebook, and hopefully I'll get lots of thumbs up, little hearts across the screen, hopefully. But this is our town hall. I thought it would be a good opportunity to talk to you and bounce some ideas back and forth and bring some things roundabout with regard to where we are in the borough. But first, I have a little bit of a story for you. I'd like to bring you back about 2 years ago at 100 Forest Avenue. You may remember or recall that time. Things were a little terse between myself and the owner, Kenny Coral. He was parking his cars up at 100 Forest. I was really angry that the cars were being parked up there because I thought it was turning into a parking lot. And then I ordered the police to remove the cars, and there was this tussle back and forth. And things didn't go too well. And the borough actually looked at the property in terms of what can we do with that property? Not really telling him what we're going to do with the property. Well, back in May, early summer this year, Bob Redman and I were walking on Halford Avenue. We noticed a table and an umbrella in that spot. And you saw Kenny Coral and his partner outside. And Bob and I went up to Kenny and said, "Wow, this is a really great use of the space. Do you think we could do something with it?" And lo and behold, we shook hands. He said, "This is great." And we put our differences aside. And what you're seeing right now with regard to that space is after Bob and I spoke to Kenny Coral, we met with Sally. And Sally had some ideas about the space herself. And she presented a wonderful thing the other night to Borough Council with regards to it. But the moral of the story is, no matter where we are at any given time, there's always an opportunity to go back and try to make friends or mend those relationships. And what we've seen over the course of this past year, there are a lot of tensions in the community. And what I'd like to bring to the community is, we're all in this together, basically. We've had issues in town, we've had issues with private property owners that have split us. I think at some time there was the Keep Narb, Narb group versus the Keep Narb, Narb, Narb group. And it was, good sign, I knew people would walk down the street and walk to the other side of the sidewalk because I didn't want to see that person. They weren't part of the other group. But what I can tell you with regard to my relationship with what happened with regard to one of the forests is we have to move on. But there's a time where there may be disputes among the parties, there may be disputes with residents in town. But we all have to learn, and we have to move on from there and make the best of it. And I think we have a great plan with regard to one of our forests at. We'd like to hear your thoughts about it tonight. Also, what do you want from the borough? What do you expect the borough to do? And also, there's other areas with regard to recreation, our downtown, our parks. What would you like to see in those parks? I know the park that, thanks to Kim Kuzak, has been a wonderful success. It's been a great meeting place, and I don't try to characterize it as the opposite of Facebook. When you're in the park, you need to talk to someone. When you have that talk, you have that dialogue going on, as opposed to the same front home behind the computer. And I think we've learned from the park that there's been success in Philadelphia. We've already been to the borough, and it's been a success as well. We have extended up until Friday, the area for Oktoberfest. So borrowing those type of mechanisms and putting them into our downtown works. And I think it's wonderful. It's a wonderful success with regard to the park. And I thank the Pizak family for making that fruition, making that together for us. But I don't have any props with me tonight. I didn't bring a movie. I didn't bring my favorite prop, which is Dennis Montana. He's always here on my side. We're on the show some pictures. But what I have behind me is a black wall. And a blank wall is because it's where you start with everything. In terms of, I want to hear your ideas about the town. What do you expect us to do about the town? What's your vision about it? I think it's a wonderful thing that residents can come up, like they did with Sally, and came up with her vision of what the downtown. But totally didn't come from any committee, didn't go from any formal group. But she had an idea. She said, "This is my vision of this corner." Whether that comes to fruition or not, we don't know. But if you like that idea, we are a participation form of government. You have council members. The mayor doesn't sit with council. The mayor sits on the side of council. But if you like something, and if you like what Sally came up with, or you have a different idea or a different version, it's incumbent upon us who reside in this town to email, contact, talk to our council members. you need to reach out. If Bob Brightwhite gets 10 emails from someone that they want chocolate ice cream at Village Streets, there's going to be chocolate ice cream at Village Streets. He's going to talk to them. And I think that's really important, because each one of us who live in town have direct contact with a council member. If you want something, you push for it, you ask for it, you keep on moving. Now, I'm going to leave the floor open. Does anyone have any questions or bring up any shit?
I would like to know more details about the PICO construction, because on the blog, I live on Chestnut, and on the blog it says it will be closed from like October 22nd till November something.
You're talking about the Monroe Road?
No,
they're doing the South Side streets. They're closing them off. We got no notice. We don't know when they're closing them off. There's no parking signs. We don't know if we leave our car, it'll be tracked. And it's a long walk, so we have to park far away. We don't know when we need to move our car. I don't know if there's some schedule where they could, I mean, that they should be informing residents, and they're not following the own schedule that is supposed to.
Well, I know last year they did the water, there was one notice about the community. This year they fall behind with our internal notice requirements. I know Sean is trying to catch up with that. I think there's some movement with regards to just putting on our web page when that's going to occur. But it's difficult.
We're at the mercy of the utility, Tom. And the utility does not, they'll give you 24-hour notice, but if you're going to be gone for more than a day or two.
No, they don't give us any notice.
There's
no notice.
I got a letter last week that said Chestnut Avenue was going to be closed.
Yeah, but it's not close.
Right, but it is a notice that they tried, and I guess they're still hung up with some.
Okay, and we didn't get the notice. Only a few people did, but not everyone.
I don't know why that would be.
Is a part of the reason because PICO just changes the plans halfway? I mean, I see them all over the world.
Aren't they going to put up temporary no parking signs? I mean, you have like mechanisms for this, right? When the other construction is being done, can they do that so we know when they're actually going to be on our block? Because every day this week we move the car, we didn't move the car, we hear them, we don't know when they're actually going to be.
We can do that if we work in conjunction with our borough office. And from what I'm hearing, and I've been over the south side a number of times during construction, it seems like we're all over the place. I can't for quite a while. It's like, usually I think of people working in one area and move to the next spot. They could be in five different locations
well,
at one time.
Someone must know the schedule. Someone's deciding it. Can they tell the borough and the borough can post it or something?
Yes. I mean, we can go back and ask the contact person from PICO with regard to that.
Okay,
does anyone else want to do anything?
Yeah.
I know you put some complaints in.
I mean, PICO has subcontracted this out to a company called Utility Line Services.
Okay.
And when they did air block with no notice whatsoever, they had a sign on the next block saying road work when nothing was going on there. And one example of an issue is all they had to do was knock on my door and ask me to move my car. But they started cutting into the street literally 2 feet behind my car. I have four claims with their claims department right now. They flooded
how's the resolution of this claim?
So we haven't gotten down to numbers, and there is a little bit of, well, Aqua didn't show up for this much time, and it's like, yeah, but you didn't block the street with sand, you know, those sorts of things. But they seem to want to really resolve issues, and that's claims, but I'd be happy to share that number, and she could probably put whoever in touch with somebody about notice.
But that's her damage or property.
No, I'm saying she would be able to refer people to, I think, you know, the right person within the company.
Perfect.
But also, you know, contacting PICO is not a bad idea because they subcontract, so.
Don't they have to get a permit from the borough or something?
I believe they have authorization, whatever right of ways they have on the south side.
I know, so there
should be better
some
cooperation between PICO and the borough to notice. My understanding is part of the frustration from the borough end is they're not knowing what PICO's doing at any given time. I think PICO is a little bit more comfortable situation. Shreen, they'll say, oh, we can't do that because we need a back call or something like that. They're going to go to the next street and start. All of a sudden, they're on the next street, and most people didn't have notice with regard to it. And they'll get back to the street that they were supposed to work on next week when the back call comes. And that's what you're getting with regard to it. It's frustrating.
Yeah, we have neighbors like with a broken arm and older people, they can't just move their car on a dime. And some, a lot of people leave their car and take a train. So
we have to learn better from what's going on the south side because they come to the north side next year.
Sean said on Monday that he has the number for the customer service guy, and he said it's very responsive, and he'll just give you the cell phone number. You can call him and say, I got a notice that the Chestnut was being done on this day. What's the story? And the guy who's in charge will give you the answers. Sean Metrick will give you the guy's cell phone number.
We've got
except his answers.
Half my neighbors got notices in Hampton, and they were extremely big.
Yeah. I mean, Karen, I can tell you on Marion where we're working this week and last week, what happened was we got the notice 6 weeks ago or something, and then we were wondering when the thing started. And then last week they set up barrels that said no parking all along Marion Avenue. And so we knew to move our cars that day. But what happened was that was just the beginning, right? They come down the first time, they do the main line down the center of the street or the side of the street. And then they come back, and they ask you, they knock on doors, and they try to find out when's a good time to turn off the gas in your home so they could hook up your line from your house to the main line. So they turned off our gas yesterday. And the biggest problem was they didn't go through a lot of effort on timing about when to reattach it. And so I didn't hear the knock on the door. They told me it'd be 3 o'clock. I was down there at 2:30. By 4 o'clock, I'm going, oh, I wonder where they are. I go outside. There's a notice on my door saying, we tried to turn the gas back on when we're at home. So then we had to wait 3 hours for Pico. We called Pico to send someone out to turn the gas back on and relay the pilot lights. But not going too far into the weeds, they did give the notification with the barrels the day before. But if you were going on a trip, you're out of luck. But as far as the daily now, where they're hooking up house by house, you don't know which part of the street they're going to be on. You don't know whose house said, yeah, Tuesday's good or Thursday's good. And 2 days ago, they managed very nicely to block us in on both ends. So you were someone that was home. East Wynwood had a big construction vehicle at one end, and Marion Avenue was blocked off on the other end. So if you had to get somewhere between 9 and 3 that day, there was no way out of the street.
That's when you call the police. because they're this utility is notorious for poor planning. Unlike Aqua, which is plans pretty darn well actually. Aqua's medium is pipes with pressurized water in them. Pico's medium is either electricity, or I guess gas is more analogous to the water, but the electricity is crazy. They don't have to plan at all, and they don't. They're sort of in the business of putting out little fires here and there, and they try to keep our antiquated network limping along, I think is the best word I could use for it. But they don't really plan, so we're never going to get long-range forecasting of when our streets are going to be shut down. But if they block off both ends of any street, that's a public safety nightmare, and that's a police matter. I'm sure.
And you're right. Jim's right. If there is an issue with regard to the kind of the police, they're more in control during the day, they're out during the day, and you work with them to stop over and you try to sort out the situation for them. Yeah. If not, they can call Sean to see Sean what's going on here as well. Because they have direct access to the car office.
They're also without that phone number to the residents.
That's
cell phone number. And is Sean reachable by phone now?
He's reachable by phone. The system has the numbers, but if you get down to, you'll find. Are they going to post the numbers above the extension numbers online?
Well, it's extensions 103.
doesn't mean he's going to pick it up.
You know, I mean, I think that information, if it's public knowledge, could be posted on the borough website. I mean, I know they're going to put a new website out, but updating the old one is not rocket science.
I know there's on the voicemail system that doesn't really give you options to call Sean directly. Something that we should update the website.
Yeah, so until that happens, perhaps somebody could just, put one of those nice notices that the world puts out. picture, you know, hey folks, we're having this go on, here's some contact numbers.
Sure.
I don't think it'll be overwhelming for the office, but it gives people the option of.
Is there anything outside of Pico to work? Going back to Station Circle and Lockhart Forest, what are your thoughts about, should they both be done together, should they be done separate? I know, Jim, you were around during the downtown project.
I've been around a long time.
So have I. I mean, I was on the downtown project committees, and I actually had the privilege of serving on borough council when the downtown project was actually going through. And that was its own self-issue nightmare. If you remember, the streets were all broken up, the sidewalks were all taken out, the light fixtures were going to go in. There was an issue with regard to Station Circle at the time. It went through different versions of what would happen up in Station Circle. I believe at one time there was also, remember the grass, there was at one time there was grass letters inlaid saying Station Circle. And that got removed as well. But at the time, Narb has changed in the extent that we value walking more now than we did 14 or 15 years ago. And Station Circle, my vision of Station Circle back 15 years ago was a pickup point. Now you get off the train, you walk across the street, you get a puppy wait for your car to come, pick you up, whether it be a cab or someone from the family dropping you off. Now we look at it, well, it's there, but why can't we make a park out of it? And I don't know whether, I hear ideas about the park area of Station Circle, but every time I look at Station Circle, I keep on remembering that trip to Rome where you have a policeman sitting in the middle and then the cars are swirling around him. And it's like, oh, I mean, he has beautiful real estate, but do we want to be out there with all these cars constantly circling? Now, we all remember back before Station Circle was built, there was a white wall, it was about 3 feet tall, that was there. I think it said Welcome to Narb on it, but it got hit a lot. I remember the marks on it, the skid marks and the bangs. And there was a tree behind it, and it really wasn't too beautiful, but it was an area where people were like, oh, I got the wall was there, otherwise the tree would have been gone, because people were going to have tents to get back into it. In its current state, it does serve the purpose as a pickup point if you get off the train and want to be picked up, but it doesn't really serve the purpose of the park as well. And it is something that you should probably look at in terms of developing, and it may not be an extensive development as well. I think one of the major complaints about Station Circle is sunlight. You know, there's no, you know, when Sally came up with like wind sails, it was more shade than people would sit there. And people do sit there, even the ice cream parlor opened up. When I drove home tonight, I drove down Hartford Avenue, there were about five people sitting there. So it is used. It's just not used as much as you'd like it to.
Keep looking at me.
I keep on looking at you. So I remember you were back there in a time period.
Have opinions about it, and I think that that whole part of town needs a comprehensive look. I want to preface these remarks by saying I'm all in favor of the plan that I saw online. I think that's a great idea. Let's encourage and favor the parklet. You know, these are things that bring life to the downtown, which it certainly has been as a planning commission member for the last 10 years or so, has been a big motivator for me is to do things to bring life to the downtown. You know, retail on the first floor, parklet is great for bringing people to sit, you know, the tables out in front of, which used to be illegal to have tables out in front of the restaurants and whatnot. Isn't it a wonderful thing when we have that now? I don't know where here.
So look the other way. It's the same issue with solo. Look the other way.
I'm all for it. So I'm all for the parklet, and I'm all for the temporary erection of a plan that was presented recently. Let's do it. I'm also, as a planner and an architect, I'm also in favor of a holistic view of Station Circle and the whole downtown. What do we need to do to all of that real estate, some of which we own or control, and some of which we don't. We don't control 100 Forest, but it sounds like Tom has forged a relationship with Mr. Coral, and maybe he can work something out. That'd be great. The long term plan, however, is a complicated animal. It's got many things going on. It's got the train arrival. It's got Santa Claus coming down off the train. It's got the liquor store. It's got, it's the exit from a parking lot behind the stores on Haverford Avenue, which we can't block up. We have to accomplish all many different things in there, but I think you can also make the town square out of it. And I think that's the place, ultimately, for the symbolic town square of Narb. I think the clock, which is a symbolic gesture, shouldn't be in front of a nail salon. It should be in the middle of a town square. And I believe that that's the place, ultimately, for the town square. I really don't think that some grand plan like that, which is expensive to realize, should stop us from doing the cool idea on 104th Avenue. Let's do that.
Tom, can I also comment on
that? Sure.
I think we have to have a comprehensive plan. I like, you know, the creativity and the ideas that were presented the other day, but, you know, the thing is, they were all centered around somebody else's property. And if we spend a lot of time and money putting that together, and this property is on the market, so what if he decides to move on? Does that force the borough to, like, buy that property at a very high price? And we have public grounds, as Jim was saying, and I think he's right. We've got to have a comprehensive plan and not just kind of set up something like a parklet, which is really wonderful and I love. I mean, some people don't like, but most people, it's a novelty, but the parklet could be part of. I mean, we're not a big city. We don't really need a parklet. We do now, but we can have that incorporated into that whole station circle. But I think it's a big project. I think it needs to be looked at. I think I think it needs to be looked at by the whole community. We have obviously great ideas coming in here. I'm just so excited about what Jim just said. Like, look at the whole thing. We revisited this a couple years ago in a town hall meeting when the borough was considering buying that property, and it was a big hullabaloo. But, you know, now Ken's there and he's got his business, and, you know, the borough can work with him on that property and maybe get some great stuff, but I'm just concerned about spending a lot of money doing something when that property could go away.
Well, when the group itself is going to be going towards the economic development community, they're going to look at different options. One thing, you can have no involvement with the borough, so it's a private enterprise. You can't go up with us on your property. If the borough wants to get involved in it, then perhaps they can work out some arrangement with First Rate Refusal if that person's set out to purchase it. It is a pretty cool, key part of the town.
Yeah.
I've always had my head involved to do something with regard to it. When I talked to Kenny, Bob and I talked to Kenny in May, the door is open. He put the record references aside and he's wanted to use that property. Not only that property, but the property that surprised me in front of this gas station, it forms an L shape. I was not looking for the sidebar, I was looking for the front. And Sally came up with this wonderful plan with regard to it. We have to get the waste of college money together. I'm not looking at a full government, okay, or everything. There's things we can do, and Sally approached that the other night as far as providing services and voice out food banks and other things coming up. It's not that complicated.
No,
a lot of those things you're talking about are like stumps, which are painted. Well, they're wonderful. They add life to that square. I don't know about digging into the ground. I'm not really pleased solving that. Suffices for getting what work.
What do you think about moving the clock of a whole comprehensive plan that includes the program? The clock's cool where it is, but that's an interesting idea. And what he's saying is true. We have such a, you know, we have all these great events, and geez, that's exciting. I mean, it would take a lot of planning.
Yeah, there should be a comprehensive plan. Just as we need a comprehensive plan with regard to our recreational facilities and even our park system as well. And even this building, we really have to take a look at where we're heading with regard to this building, kind of refurbishing the
building.
So it may come
in
different realms. It's just kind of where it's going to come in funding out of regard to, but we do have the opportunity now with regard to Hunter Forest to do something. I've had a couple of movie nights up there. It's a pretty cool space. I relax some of the balls with regards to people enjoy it. They have a good time. They bring their solo cups in. It's wonderful. They have a great time out there and enjoy the band.
It looked like a big city.
I like trying to experiment with this. I'm not on to dumpster culture. I mean, You know, I'm talking about people actually rent dumpsters, make swimming pools out.
Wow.
I'll pass on that. There's also, I think someone does it out back in pickup trucks. Whatever it is, it actually brings a life to downtown, and people have started to kind of reconnect. You know, it's really cool to see someone sit there and read a book or somebody. And someone put sun up there the other day, or that was pretty. We do need some shade. We need some wind sails or some parachute control, which would make it very cool.
There's really not that many spaces that we have. I mean, when we look at the downtown, we have that corner. Station Circle. A comprehensive plan, which is necessary. It's not, you know, it's not that complicated. So we have a really big opportunity here. I need to see this pass. And there's quantifiable evidence about what these kinds of pop-up spaces do to the state. We can get that data. We can start looking at these numbers and how they are. It's a thrilling opportunity.
Yeah,
I
just
hate to see us
misagree. Just a neighbor the other night, I talked to Joe, I talked to John LaBarge, a lot of great sales. Tracy said we didn't close your doors in time.
She couldn't, because people kept walking in.
So do we want that now? Do we want that? I'm sorry.
Yeah, I would agree. This is such a terrific opportunity. And I remember also that we talked about this a couple of years ago. Both properties, and so I'm wondering, how can we move it forward, you know, so that it doesn't take 10 years to realize these plans, because I think Sally's ideas are terrific, and I'd love to put that into place, and I'd love to have a rendering of what Station Circle could look like, and put those drawings in front of the public, and start doing it, because, I mean, my sense is there's enormous support. Such a positive addition to the quality of life.
Actually, implement the plan in 3 or 4 weeks. 3 or 4 weeks. Now, how long it takes us as a council and as a community to mishmash with, you know, large scale plans, that's another story.
Right.
But if we want it, it could happen in 3 to 4 weeks. This woman oversaw the viaduct apartment that
yes.
Everybody came down, and that was built in about 3 to 6 weeks, and that's a much grander scale. It's a lot more dynamic, it's a bigger budget. So, you know, everybody seems that we want behind this. I think we just need to make sure that the others on council let me know.
And yes.
Something you'd like to see this year, this spring,
yes.
This fall, or not, because we can talk about grand plans all around.
That's what Bob gets. I mean, if you send emails or talk to council members, or say, I want this, then we'll get time. We will. Because the sweet people against the briefs. That's what happened.
There had been a whole discussion about Lingering Station Circle on one of the Facebook groups, I think, Narb Community Network. And someone had done a rendering, which I can kind of reproduce, not exactly, but if I can vary it. Paper. I think it's solved. It preserves the parking
mm-hmm.
and the exit and makes it pedestrian friendly. And someone, I'm not an architect, so I should look that up. But
my 11-year-old has done a rendering.
Is the main problem with Station Circle where the benches are situated in such a way that they don't
house?
It's
the parking lot for the state store.
We can talk about, if you start talking about two-way parking spots, you need to find other parking
right.
spots, otherwise the merchants are going to be very
yeah,
upset.
So we can do that.
So it's all solved.
That 31 next to the surgeries.
That's right, or the thing.
Yeah. So the Station Circle, it felt, to my opinion, I mean, it felt separate from the parking, that you weren't surrounded by a sea of cars.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. And maybe something like the pallet wall. You just put a small barrier that you felt like almost like a small enclosure with a couple of gaps for people to walk through. Even that, which is really simple, could make that space more
usable. I agree, no matter what you do in Station Circle, if you don't do it with the sea of cars, it's
right.
not going to work. It's going to be successful.
Yeah, I mean, I am really for Station Circle being the first parking overhaul. I think it's wonderful. I love Sally's presentation. one thought I had about it, because of some of the concerns that you raised, Deborah, is might we be able to get a lease of a certain number of years, even if it was basically a gift, because I wouldn't want to move forward.
That would be the premise of actually doing the investment. You want to lease from 5 to 10 years a minimum, and then move on for the right to purchase after.
Could you speak up?
Sorry, I keep on getting away from the microphone. At least 5 to 10 years would be required to some investments. So initially, you could release the enjoyment and use that space for a time period, plus the option again to purchase again the other side of stuff.
I just wanted to say that as we start thinking about this, and I know there are some of us on the planning commission who have been thinking about this for quite a while. I think it's also important to expand the thought process a bit and to think about the station itself. You know, when it was done and the historic station was torn down, what was put back was probably thought to be pretty cutting edge in the 70s. But it's the end of its useful life. And although it might be another 20 years before Amtrak ever gets around to replacing it, I think we need to start engaging that conversation with whether it's Amtrak or SEPTA. There are very different attitudes about what the building should be that replaces what's there now than it was in 1970. And it can be a real opportunity, a real once in a 50-year opportunity to, if not restore what was there, at least bring back the original feeling of the station circle. And if we don't actively engage the public entities that control that site, one day we're just going to see construction equipment show up and start, and we won't have any input at all. So, and because this is a process that could easily be 10 or 20 years, we need to start thinking about that aspect of it too. Yeah, the station, the train station. No, we don't. That's what I'm saying. We don't have control of it. But if we don't engage Amtrak and what could be done with that site, they're going to go off and do whatever they want.
So you're saying we might be able to have control?
We certainly can have a seat at the table to talk about it.
Who was the one that chose to tear it down and who chose to build that?
Was it SEPTA or Amtrak? I know there are other SEPTA stations that are almost identical to it, so they probably did several at the same time.
It was abandoned for years. I remember in some of the towns we talked about how they were doing well somehow. There were some issues with regard to who was actually having, and they tore it down and they built that. I'm curious about, I mean, I don't know the station has to lap. There's no ticket sales in there.
There are.
Till noon. Actually, Dave brings up a very urgent point, because within a year and a half, we're going to be ticketless where everything will be slide cards and such, and they'll not be some other years. At that point, they will phase out the building. It will probably be just a closed building. Mm-hmm. I know I've reached out to SEPTA and continue to reach out to see if we can get a conversation, like you're saying, because it's a great opportunity to coffee shop or something that we can control, at least an open air shelter that they don't have the liability against. But it is an urgent matter, actually, so we're not very important.
But we really, when we were talking about the new zoning code, I like to talk about, we're thinking in a 50-year window. And this whole, the 100 Forest site, the station circle, and the station itself, we have a 50-year opportunity here to really mold the center of the town, and we can't lose it.
There's an apples and pears here thing too, Tom. There's the inbound station, which was the one that was built as a prototype, and it was actually constructed at about half a dozen sites around the Philadelphia region by SEPTA. The thing with the scratched plastic windows and the ticket sales. That was unfortunately a budget-driven and ill-considered design, I think, short-sighted, unfortunately, and will undoubtedly either have to be extensively renovated by SEPTA at some point or replaced, because it was just a bad idea when they did it. They tore down the funky old wooden shelter that was there. Many of us may remember. I furniture do. It was falling apart. It was held together by lead-based paint at the time. Many, many years before that, the handsome old Victorian outbound station, which is the one that was replaced by Circle Travel Building, the state store building, is there now. And that was a handsome artifact of the 19th century that we are sorry to have lost. And it was long before any of us probably were active in Narb. Some of us may have lived here, but I bet you we're small children at the time. The thing that I think Dave is talking about is that aluminum cantilevered shelter.
Well, I'm talking about both sides.
Yeah, which is the thing that faces the station circle that is really not a handsome thing either. And that was
it. Is it just because it's not handsome or has it gone?
It doesn't perform the function that you'd want it to perform.
So, but does SEPTA rank things in terms of maybe useful life? Does SEPTA rank that? Like they know that the station has to be replaced? They can probably look at the bridge system. Like, we know this bridge is going to go. We can access
it. They don't even know the useful life of their train car.
To the extent that there are six or eight of these identical stations, it's probably on somebody's radar.
Have any been replaced by something? The other six or eight?
Well, the one I'm aware of certainly hasn't.
I heard that they have, like, they're in line to be replaced, but maybe with this new system coming where they don't even need a ticket taker person or ticket sales, they're not going to replace it. Maybe they're kind of biding their time, and I really don't know, but it's interesting. I mean, the idea that you could have a coffee shop there or something interesting for them to go. I mean, how do we have to approach them to find this out?
Right.
So
that's Dave's point, I think, Deborah, that to getting a seat at the table and having an influence in a long-range planning process that these bureaucratic businesses, SEPTA and Amtrak, engage in every day. They're planning things many years out, and if we want to have an impact on what is done in our town, we need to elbow our way into a conversation with them.
Right, make it human.
It's kind of like the bridge.
There's certainly precedent for it. I mean, there's the Jenkintown Station, I haven't been there in years, but a wonderful restaurant. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are precedents of taking.
So you can do that kind of stuff at a such a station.
There's a coffee shop by the Woodlands.
In Winslow.
I mean, that's.
We
need more people who can actually have the time to even address these things. You know, I mean, we've got to work on some planning commission.
That's my question with regard to, if you look at a master plan with regard to the train station and station circle in One Heart Forest, Sally's design, it seemed like it's pretty mobile, in terms of you can pick up that ping pong table, you pick up that tree and stuff, you can do these different things. So if there is a master plan which is to come out later on, I don't think there's anything that shows there that it's so irreversible that it couldn't be melded to the other two as well. So if we're looking for something like more immediate in terms of we have this opportunity in One Heart Forest, perhaps we should move on. And at the same time, move forward with regard to the master plan, with regard to the train station circle, and One Heart Forest.
Yeah.
And knowing that One Heart Forest is modifiable, which I want to have. I love Sally's plans, but we also have different uses for that space at given times during the course of the year. And we may want to be able to have those things moving around to do a movie night or to do something else along those lines. So I think that's something which we should talk about and move forward.
And nothing engages. She listed how many different groups that would start to participate. And if you look at the city, Neural Arts, that has evidence as to what that does to community participation and how that just begets more community participation.
It's amazing. In Philadelphia, we go around, part of my field trip is to find out where the next beer garden is going to be. Parks and Path in Philadelphia, we have a lot of them. We see a lot of stuff going on. And there's always a buzz about it. There's always people surrounding everyone's lost. So no matter what you do, the simple thing from benches to parachutes above to just having the lights creates a nice little scene for everyone to actually get together and talk. And the wonderful thing about the Parks and Tap, a lot of them don't have Wi-Fi. Nobody's really hanging on their cell phone, their computers. People are sitting there having a beer, they're sitting there and talking to people, which is really nice. It's a lot different. sit at least at the dinner table or somewhere in front of their cell phone. So it's nice. It's a good time. I'm sorry. Yeah.
So I just want to say that I'm definitely a big fan of the open space, community open space. I feel that all of us are sort of desperate for that here. I mean, yes. That's why we love Narberth. It's like we're community people. You know, we want that interaction. So I'm a big fan of Sally's plan. I think definitely let's do it. I do think that that is a good short-term thing to try and do, and why not? I do think thinking long-term, ideally, something has to be done with the building at the 100 Forest property. And like, you know, do we repurpose it? Do we knock it down? Do we make it? I don't know.
We don't know.
But if we're just dreaming, you know, and talking really long-term, I mean, I think that the footprint of that building needs to be included in any real serious, you know, open space planning, including that property. And, you know, I think that the revitalization and energy that can be inserted into the downtown with that type of space is just amazing.
That may very well come at some point in the future with regard to Mr. Crowley's sites to sell his property.
Right.
We have the first right refusal on the purchase, and we can certainly go ahead.
Right.
And if the funds are available, we can cobble together the right lending sources. We'll buy it. I agree with you, but for purposes of now, he's been very generous to us.
Yeah.
And, it's been a sea change in terms of our relationship with Mr. Quarrel. He wants us to enjoy that space. He wants us to build it up there. And he gets used for it as well. His own clients, people over here during the day. He can make a coffee house. You can make all these little coffee gardens, beer gardens, all these different little things there. And he gets enjoyment from it as well. But if sometime in the future that the property itself does become available, I'm sure the borough would be interested in matching his price and moving forward.
Right.
But right now, we're just very thankful that he's generous.
Right.
He's
on
the property. Agreed.
Yes.
Well, I have two things to say. One is that the train station, there are precedents for restoring old train stations, like in Lansdowne, and I think that was damaged by fire, I think. Overbrook, I think, and I'm not sure what participation the community had in that, but I think we should check it out because I think in Lansdowne there's a lot of historical interest and there might have been some funding for that. I don't know, and I don't know where it came from. But the other thing is with four-story buildings being allowed in downtown, I wonder whether the price of that lot will ever be cheap enough to buy, and you think about that, what incentives we're creating by zoning that way, and what that will do to a possibility for open space, because realistically, that may not happen.
It goes back to a lot of kind of what your thoughts are, what our downtown should be. Is it a bustling downtown? Is it a lively downtown, or is it a city downtown? My parents live in a town called Wigmore, and when I was a kid, all the kids are around, but they all grew up and left. And if you go down Wigmore, you see some tumbleweeds. It's sad. It's sad. It's a sad area. I like Marver because you can go back 10 years, it was pretty quiet. I mean, stores even went not open or whatever, and I think there's been a big change recently with regard to what a Friday night is or what a Saturday night is in Marver, even Thursday or Wednesday. There's a lot more foot traffic, there's more people out the street. Do we want to build on that? Well, if you build on that, it makes for a strong business base, too. I'd like to see someone. I mean, I'm going to be Philadelphia most of the day. I would like to shop in the time of Margaret. I'd like some of the stores to stay open later. I think it's something we would like. You need to figure out where you see yourself in terms of what type of town you want. We don't live in the countryside, not with our borough. The boroughs are taking parts of it. We're not a city, but people do with all the children and the shoulders and walk around and people want to see they want to be out of town. I think that's great. I really do. Ice cream power has added a lot to that. The bars are the bars, but when we have quiz, at least see more people. I go to quiz on a lot, but it's sort of, it's there. Do we want that? We want more people living in the county. We want to have more. That's something that we're going to have to work our way through with the Form Based Zoning Code and questions about it and what has to be modified or not modified. And get a sense of that.
So, can I segue into something else?
Sure. Does anyone else have any questions?
This is about the previous topic, so can I just finish this?
Sure.
Okay. This is not my idea, but I think it's a good idea. Currently, if you're coming through the tunnel, you have to cross the circle where people are backing out in a big hurry, and then you have to cross it again to get to Habakkuk Avenue. It's not pedestrian friendly at all. So the idea that was proposed was to keep this exit here out of the parking lot, move all of the parking spots out to diagonals off of the street, and make this whole place like a fuscaing zone, like a pedestrian with tables and trees and whatever. That way you come out of the tunnel, there's a space there you can cross once to go to the sidewalk, and it would be far more pedestrian friendly. That high planter thing is kind of ugly and doesn't really serve much of a purpose other than preventing cars from getting into it.
That's the whole thing.
Okay. But this, I mean, then you have this whole large pedestrian area that could be a center gathering place for all sorts of things.
I trust the planning commission to move that between the center and the waters. Is there any questions at this point?
I'm slow. What are you saying that Mr. Coral is he's not expecting rent?
There's an arrangement which can be drafted with regard to he's wanting to let the borough use the property. In response to that, we should have a whole harmless identification agreement in place with regard to activities that occur there. He's also interested in doing a rental arrangement, a dollar rate for use of the property. That's something we can talk about, but that has to be negotiated between the council and council's attorney, the solicitor, and the borough. He's told me that he doesn't have plans for that property, and to my surprise, I didn't know we even had plans for the front of this property. That's why we have it all designed from sound. I know our sister has reached out to Mr. Carl's council. There's been some discussions with regard to it. Nothing's been signed or executed. That's something which would have to go with our council on the approval as well. But the talk is there. And he actually, Mr. Carl actually enjoys us being there. I'm not sure you got a chance to go to movie nights where people are hanging out and watching movies and having a good time. He was there too. He was watching me as well. He thought it was a really good use of the space. So if you think of different other things to do, like this Friday, trying to get, if anyone has a band, a show, a baseball band, you could really use one for Friday night. Maybe we could do something like that as well on Friday, where a band plays out there in the parking area, and people sit in the park there. But there's some ideas you can think of that space and what you did to make the line up the downtown. Mr. Coral benefits from it as well, because it's pretty ugly. You're like, what is that actual turf and what is this thing here? So he gets a benefit from the investments that the borough would make or private group would make, or maybe cobble groups. It could be IBA money, it could be borough money, there could be some investment from the business community into it as well. Maybe some of the bars see some benefit with regard to having it there. Obviously, their sales have increased as a result of it, so maybe they're going to be taking something. Maybe we get lifetime work from Boy Scouts or other groups or the Shade Tree Commission to plant trees there in that area. That's some things we can do with regard to it. So I think it's pretty open. I think council likes the idea. Everyone had questions of where did this come from? And I tried to explain that piece in the beginning. Started as a corner conversation in one of the bars. And we went on to talking to Sally, and Sally was very fast and very quick with things. And the way she did divide the downtown in terms of miles is amazing. And she drew that whole thing out for us. So she has an idea. She has a plan with regard to it. She's been thinking for it for about close to 20 years. She's helped it to use that space. So hopefully we can move forward with it. Like I said before, contact your council members, say we want this, please do what you can do, fast track it, get it done so that it doesn't. But at the same time, I do realize that we do have a greater responsibility with regard to coming up with a master plan for that area. and we have to look at the train station, we have to look at Station Circle, and we have to look at 100 Forest Hill in conjunction. And I can, that could run on the same sidetrack as this. I don't see them getting contrary to each other.
Stay on that topic?
Yes, actually.
Yeah, a couple things. I want to make sure I'm understanding. I think you just said that, that whatever would be, if something materialized with 100 Forest, that there would be rent paid by the borough to Penn Park.
It's about rent. And I don't know what those numbers are.
No, and I don't expect you to, but I just want to be clear because I've heard rumors about exorbitant rent and is yeah. there rent, and so
I would tell you, though, there would be, the devil is in the details with regard to, I mean, having general events there is wonderful. Like, if you start doing beer garden sales there, I would think that Mr. Crowley, at least I'd jump on their side and say, hey, you should get a percentage. You know, that's all in negotiation if it gets there. We're not there yet. To it, and that could be done by riders or agreements or whatever. So you could have a standard agreement with him, but then have an agreement afterwards with regard to, okay, if we use it, then what we can do. And then we can decide at that point. But right now, we're only looking for it to use as a general access area.
Right, no, I get it. And the stuff that's happened there has been wonderful. I was down there for both part of one movie and all of the second one, and it's been very cool. I just want to say the thing that the beauty of the parklet is that it happened. We had the meeting, two town hall meetings ago. There was lots of interest expressed in doing something with Station Circle.
Yeah.
And I think that's a great idea. I mean, I'd absolutely go along with Jim that a couple reasons. One is that we own it. There doesn't have to be all that negotiation and concern. You know, the last I heard, the 100 Forest Avenue property was on the market for $800,000. And we own Station Circle already. And so, things could happen there, perhaps, that wouldn't be a great big deal, but could actually be done as opposed to spending years talking about it. If we had to talk about a parklet and it had to go through the system, it either never would have happened or it would have gone on for a very, very long time. Instead, there were people who were willing to just do it, and someone who was willing to cooperate to say, yeah, let's do it and make it happen. So I think the long-term planning and comprehensive planning, that's all great, and yet, in the interest of actually materializing something that we talk about, I think Station Circle has tremendous potential. I happened to drive by today and I saw there was nobody in the park, but it just so happened at that time, and it was one person sitting at Station Circle. And just real quick, I actually have to credit this to Ken Kovitsky. He had made the comment, if you really observe like the psychology and the sociology of what happens at the parklet, it's entirely different from what happens at Station Circle. Because there you have tables and chairs for two people. So what's likely to happen is my friend and I may decide to go there and we're going to sit and talk to each other. When I go to the parklet, I invite people in. Whenever I see someone walking by that I don't know and I realize they're looking like, what is that? And should I just keep going and say, hey, have you been in the parklet? Come on in. And so it creates a whole different dynamic. And I think there could be ways to make Station Circle more amenable to that sort of interaction.
I agree. It has to replicate 100%, but you have to deal with the bars, and that's going to be where the problem's going to be in terms of all parents' plans. When you start taking away parking spaces from businesses, they get.
It doesn't take away spots. It just moves. That's the thing. We have the same number of spots.
It's a manageable problem, Tom. Trust me.
I'm sure we'll figure it out.
I hate to say trust me. I don't have blonde hair, but trust me.
You know how Open Streets Philly on Saturday morning? I mean, could we just have like Open Street Station Circle one day and like with the police barrier just block off the exit from McShay's and just have the rest of it just be open, just see what that's like for a day?
Interesting.
Like, not have people parking there?
We can try that. Again, I'm very sensitive to the businesses and their parking situations.
Right.
You see when Ed has a great idea. When you take away a parking spot, remember, we call this parklet 2.0, it was moved into 15 minutes. But when it was up at the other spot, there was some resistance with regard to taking that parking spot.
Right.
I think what's going to happen eventually is we're going to have a parking study done, which Bob was put in place in regard to Borough Council. We have an idea of where people park, where they go, and we can play around with that for a little bit. It would be wonderful to have that area cut off for a day, a Saturday. And, probably handled the liquor store concerns and some of the other emergency county thing. And then after my family was like, oh, you're taking away my apartment spot, my clients came to me. So it's something we have to, this is hard thought about, to deal with. Not a lot, I don't know, time.
Have you ever been part of the fitness station?
That's very funny.
Or to Georgette's point, why don't we just treat this as a parklet, a pop-up, and just do it, see what happens, and do it at Forest Avenue, and try it out. Get the community engaged. I mean, we have enough people who are excited about it. Try it.
I get the sense. It's not movable. When we move the park, it looks kind of very, we're going to miss it. If we have an empty park, where are we now? Are we going to stay? That's why it's important to please get this moving forward with our staff. I agree. Yes.
So, to talk about the vision for the downtown, so I feel that there's a lot to discuss, but I feel like there should be, in my opinion, like with borough council, there needs to be more focus on what do we want the downtown to be from an economic development perspective. In some senses, it feels like the downtown exists just to serve the residents. It's just really our little playground. We go down, we shop. And then there's another potential for it that maybe it could be a shopping, dining destination, with attractive retail and restaurants, more attractive than we have now or whatever, just the vision of it being different, that we want people to come here.
Invariably, I think you're right with regard to it. The way we're looking at retail now across the board, how many of us order from Amazon? How many of us do drops? How many get stopped? I just mentioned to Karen to tell you about a little coffee at 3.5 hours to order if you want.
Oh my
God. Scary, because why would you do, the issues with the shop? So you're going to see a lot more, whether you like it or not, probably more restaurants, more food places coming up, that's where you're going. Because I know in Philadelphia there was an article recently with regard to the third of the leases or whole restaurants.
Why is that a bad thing?
Some people like it, some people don't like it. We have to figure out where the town is headed and what we want with regard to that. We treasure Ricklands.
Right.
We like going there to get something from Ricklands, but if Ricklands turned into a nice restaurant, we're going to miss Ricklands. Where would we be with that? Maybe some candy. I mean, I don't think we're ever going to be able to replicate the candy bar aisle. Where's that candy?
Really?
How many times have we been all my kids and we're going to release their lunch for there? Stuff.
Right, so I think that there are parts of our downtown that are, a little quirky, like Mapes or American Family Market, where part of the appeal of it is that it is, a little mom and pop. It's been there forever. That's why we love it. And there are parts of our town that's what we love about it. I'm also a proponent for having a nice mix of things like that, and then also newer, hip, interesting stores and restaurants that people want to hang out in. I think that you can have both.
That's going to come. I'm just telling you with regard to, I get calls. My office is down in 24 Walnut. A lot of real estate people in the city, they all know about Narb. They know that Narb is the place to go. The minute you start thinking about having a child or moving out of the city, Narb is. They call it the Narb Shop. Narb, you leave Fishtown, hit right out to Narb. You're going to see more and more. It's a good thing. And when people come from Fishtown or some of the other areas in Northern Beast County, bring these ideas with them. They love parklets because they're used to having parklets in
county.
Right. They're like, wow. I've had people come up and say, well, I sold this down in front of Pizza Brain or one of the other places in the county. We can do this.
It almost muffles it. I hear all this, and I kind of agree with what you're saying, because we have these older shops that are very nostalgic and that we treasure for one reason, and then there's some other newer stuff that some of us would like to see come in, the coffee shop, restaurants that are not just pubs and the TVs. So how do we handle, to make Narb the destination, you have to have parking. What is the idea? What could we do for parking? Is there even a possibility of even building maybe a tri-level?
I think it's also a question of, do we want it to be a destination? I think that's something that we need to explore. I think at first
thought, you think, yeah, because we live here, we want more interesting stuff.
Business would want it to be a destination. In order to get interesting businesses here, they're going to need that.
Right, there's a lot of positives about having it be more of a destination, but there can be some negative impacts for the people that live in a community,
well,
a dense community, so just something to explore.
And that's one of the things I was segueing into is, you know, the whole, the form-based zoning code that's come here. I don't think what we're having parking's been done, but I don't think it hasn't been done, if I'm correct.
No, and the parking study is going to be done, but the other, we look at our marketing efforts, we have a lot of people from the western suburbs now, but we also have a large group from Philadelphia. Like we're such a short distance from Center City. We have bus line going through Haverford Avenue. We have a train coming out. They want to come. Yeah, I'm not sure if you've ridden on the train on Friday nights. Trains are crowded Friday nights in the town. Come back. And it'd be great if you could grab some of that business from here.
It would be good to grab the business, but then again, you have the people who live here. And, you know, how are they going to be impacted?
Yeah.
And neighborhoods that, you know, are traditionally residential, dare I say, don't want their neighborhoods to be filled up with stuff that they didn't come here for. So, you know, there is a section for this, and we have to address how to handle that kind of stuff, but without alienating the human beings that actually bought houses here to live here.
Well, you're going to realize that there's a lot of people that are living here or are living away from the city, and they're used to dense areas. Compacted spaces at this point. We're different.
And you know that our the densest communities in Pennsylvania already. It's already considered one of the densest communities in Pennsylvania. And, you know, I haven't done a poll of who's moving here and what they might like, but frankly, I'm not sure I agree with you. They may be used to the city, but they're leaving the city.
Well, for other reasons. But they
are leaving the cities. Leaving here from the city, not for the schools, but to be less, you know, in a community that was where there was less anxiety, quieter, but still had sidewalks and could get train public transportation. We did not move to the city for school, to Robert for the schools, although it was a plus. It was very nice. But and I think that I'm sure there are people who do both, but I think that there are a lot of people from Philadelphia who wanted a different kind of neighborhood.
So you said the schools in your
absolute. Well, I think it's time to work with our schools. You'd be surprised. I mean, on a 5-year Saturday night, with kids in tow, a couple strollers, having a beer, relaxing, enjoying it. It really brought some life back into that area.
They want to go home and be able to park in front of their house.
Well, we learned. I understand that, but the issue is that we can provide this to them, and that's the new generation that's coming through, the 20s and 30s are coming through, this is what they're looking for. Eventually they're going to be standing where I am, you know, sometimes.
We knew that that's what they're looking for, I'm not sure.
Well, they come out, they love the school system, they love, if they're going to move to a borough, they kind of think the borough is somewhat different than the countryside. Further away, say further out, like college or some other areas closer to the city. They like to be able to walk out and get a pizza. Studies have shown the younger ones. But they want weight pizza. I don't know, like, that's sort of what you're looking at, so, because the demographics are shown time and time again. They're not cooking at home. They want to go out for food, they're going to go buy food. And I'm getting a lot of pressure. I mean, why don't we have food trucks in Canada? I'd like to try. Yeah, you
swear. No, I had a vision when you said that of food trucks parking the main street. I'm like, my squinting was, where are they going to go?
Well, how would you feel if there was a taco truck at 100 Fires?
It's fine with me. No, it's fine with me. That's fine.
That's the restaurants. That's
I don't want it in front of my house, but I'm fine with it in front of my house. I mean, right in front of that house. That's the center of town. So the center of town. I'm happy with being dense and having things to do, but I'm saying if we're going to make it, you know, if we're going to try and, you know, do more, we have to figure out where all these cars are going to go. That's all. I mean, I don't think anybody who moved here into these, you know, in whether it's a $200,000 house or a $1 million house, wants to not have a parking place in front of their house, wants to have a building knocked down next to them and a 5-unit apartment building stuck in it. I really don't think that's what they come to Narb for. I think they come to Narb for what you're talking about. But they don't come to Narb so that the house next to them can be bought off with the house next to it, knocked down, and a flat-top apartment building stuck there next to them. I don't think that's why they come here, Tom. I know that's not why they come here.
No, I understand. And we're going to learn more and more about the parking studies on where these cars go.
This is what the form-based zoning code has brought, and I think that we need to understand. And I think that we made a big mistake in not doing a build-out and showing people exactly what could happen at the property next to them. I think that was a big mistake. And now we're finding out, hey, guess what? We have an 18-unit apartment building. Whoops, didn't realize that. Whoops. Well, that's not fair to the people who live here. And that needs to be done.
And that will be addressed and corrected through the changes that they're going to.
We can't go back. We can't go forward with a smarter outlook than we had before.
And we're all going to have that opportunity with regards to moving forward. I mean, we can't, part of it is, I'm really happy that it took us at least an hour, 15 minutes before you start talking about the church, because it's sharing. I understand. But it happens.
That
part is over. We can learn from what happened in the past. We can move forward. If there's changes to the form-based zoning code, Bob Weisberg and his group are going to address those changes in regard to what your corrections are and what changes have to be happening. Get it right. We're not right. The form-based zoning code is not perfect, but it's getting there. And we need to work on it to the point that we get in that. That requires community participation, community questions. And really dressing in and maybe tell what you really want from our town, let me say.
I wanted to respond, I don't know what your name is, but about the types of stores you're going to have here. It's not the stores like Mapes and Ricklands and American Family Market, they're not just cute or nostalgic places. First of all, they represent the original working class people of Narb. And I'm really uncomfortable with this becoming like a hipster, cutesy destination. That's not why I came here. I mean, I'm really concerned about Mapes leaving. I go there 2 or 3 times a week. I don't want to have to drive somewhere to go pick up a notebook or a doodad or whatever, or for my kids to, my kids can walk in and go get something. I think we really need anchor stores that sell practical things like food and, staples, not staples, but basic stuff like kitchen doodads or whatever. And I think the town is really in trouble if we become all cutesy doodad hipster or little toasts, places or with no anchor of actually, I love Sweet Mabel and all that, but we also need practical down-to-earth stores that sell everyday things, and I know that they may be priced out, but I don't know if there's a way that the borough can encourage that.
Well, we can encourage people to do this by local, but there's going to be certain market forces which are not going to be able to control.
Right. We can't buy local if the store's not there.
We encourage people to buy local, buy other things local. Do all of us do that? By the number of UPS trucks in the borough, FedEx trucks, that was worth going to Amazon and so on. You know that. You see them all over the place.
I always look at Mapes first. And, I'm concerned about, not everyone drives. Not everyone can drive or wants to drive. I don't want to have to go to Target to get one little, to get socks. It's, it's really going to have an impact.
Then we need to buy local. Hopefully there's going to be that factor which we're not going to have much control over, such as the person who owns the store and they're investing in whether they can get a better return or do something else.
But Tom, there are ways the borough can control things or ordinances about what kinds of businesses can occupy. Yeah. I mean, they've done that in the past, making it more difficult to have a restaurant or
a lot of parking issues. But there was always that pressure with regard to parking to open that up more so we could have more food establishments. So that part's been moved. If we're looking to go back, I think it's something we have to do again with regard to the code and see whether we're moving, whether there's restrictions back in place to keep a store. So the landlord doesn't have any other choice.
went to some regions as opposed to some food.
Tell me, you have control for open storefront windows, you have control for retail on the first floor. So, you know, where
which hasn't worked very well.
It actually has. We don't have any more insurance agents. We don't have any more insurance agents than we did. We haven't lost storefronts, we haven't lost retail spaces to businesses. So I think they've been very effective legislation. And there is only so much that you can do legally, as you know. You can't discriminate. You can't tell a coffee shop that one is permitted and another is not. So you do what you can.
Well, what you can also do that we're not doing is you can strategically do like proprietor recruitment, and you can think about like what is our downtown, what do we want, and what do we not want, and you can over a long term period create a mix of stores. So my first job out of college, I worked for a company that was called Manium Development Corporation. So that is a BID, it's a business improvement district for the downtown of Manayunk. So they did everything from like the street cleaning to the marketing, long-term capital improvement projects. So I spent like the first 3 years of my career there.
How do you control?
So you don't control.
Yeah, that's the question. How would you put those? Are they government subsidies, or how do you do it regarding?
Well, with retail recruitment, you can recruit and target people that you want. So
isn't it variable to landlord? I mean, the landlord. Is
well, you have to the business. The borough council or whoever it is, you have to have working relationships with landlords and property owners that have the same vision and that want to create the same, because it's good for them too. So it comes from like that sort of shared vision with the property owners, and you have to do it in that way. And then also like with the planning commission.
Mm-hmm. I understand, Georgia.
So several things, and Kim just touched on something that I was gonna bring up, the whole notion of recruitment. And I was around for the downtown project stuff, and I remember that back then the mantra was, we don't want to turn into Manium. We don't want to turn into Manium. Because there you have a working class downtown area where one time in history people could go to a store and buy a hammer or whatever. Now you have high rents and fancy restaurants and stuff. And so I think it's really important that we think about what we've been and what we want to be, and what we want to be may be changing. There may be more people here today who wanted to be the cutesy little boutique whatever, but for my purposes, I would much rather have Nate's than a restaurant I can't afford to eat in anyway. So that practical kind of stuff to me is part of what makes it a true downtown. You need to be a destination to some degree, because a town this size cannot support its own downtown without anybody else coming in. So you have to be a draw from outside. But do you want to turn into just a place where you can only go in cute little shops, but you can't get that screwdriver that you need, that you could get in 10 minutes if you walk downtown here in Narb now?
That's a reality. It's not unique to us. I mean, this is happening across the country.
Just let me finish, because I remember what we did back then with the downtown project is that we brought in a woman who was with probably the organization that you're talking about. Yes, and she did a whole presentation. Of course, we're not Manium. We don't have a salary to pay somebody to do that. But I remember realizing, oh, okay, instead of just sitting and waiting till a landlord decides who they're going to rent to, you make an active effort, and maybe this is something that the Economic Development Committee can be more involved in. You think about what you want, and you make an active effort to recruit what you want. You don't have control, but you certainly can have influence, and I think that's a lot of stuff that we need to pay attention to. It's not simple. There's not one answer. We want to do this or we want to do that. There's a lot to be discussed about that.
I agree, and I think there's a lot of factors involved in it, such as the possible tenants for the rent meters. You can look at different landlord things as well in terms of what the landlord has to do. He has the best of the property. He wants to get a return on the investment. Sometimes they'll look for the best, fastest way, but we have to direct them the way which may not be the top dollar, but also provide the service or maybe a complement to his other stores that he also owns the downtown.
When we came to Narb 26 years ago, we really came here because it was a walking community, and there you didn't have to have a park animal. But what we really missed were coffee shops in the city. We we missed restaurants that aren't bars with TVs in them, same thing you'd said. When, at that time, a store couldn't revert to, it had to revert to a former use that was lost. So you couldn't come in and put a coffee shop where there had once been one, but in between was McCandless oil, okay. Right? And you also couldn't have tables out on the street by restaurants. And when I saw Narb really, really come alive was when people could sit outside on a summer evening and people really started coming in. If we do something with Station Circle, again, you're going to be bringing people in. I'm all with you and just trying to have some balance so we continue to be a walking community for things we want and need and for entertainment and to gather within our community. And I really think it can be both. I think a lot of it is going to be how the buildings are designed. It's going to look like Phoenixville now looks, which is not a place I'd want to go anymore.
Much
taller buildings, brick that looks more like Station Circle, like the liquor store, that go up. Instead of having one story, you have four story buildings, things like that. I think we have to be really careful. So I feel like we need to first be a community for our community. And there are enough places, enough suburbs right around here who are coming more and who are going to keep coming more the more that we do. And I feel like we have to be careful about growing up too fast. We have to not just think about what we want, but it shouldn't happen all at once. And not, I'm going to say something about the church, not as a complaint at all. No, really, I don't want to go there. But I think we really have to think of how quickly we want to move, how fast we want to push legislation through, without just really thinking what serves our community first. And I think we all agree it includes business space, because that's part of it being a walking community. I think a lot of us really like to buy books. But I think that it needs to not happen all at once. And I think we need to be careful what doors we're opening.
There's some things with the Gardner downtown, which there was a study which George had referenced years ago. It's a beautiful book, like how we first encouraged businesses to leave the lights on three times so that you wouldn't go walking in the downtown. How we want them to put their goods out onto the sidewalk area, how they would spread out in the doorway, how important it is. There's things that should be there, but we encourage and we don't bother, such as A-frames and tables. I know if you go down Center City or 12th Street, you see how the table covers have changed. If there's one restaurant that takes over three other storefronts like that, they just put tables out, they serve. I've seen a little bit of that creepy with regard to our downtown, and it's good. I'm happy with that. So there's things that we can do to encourage the downtown, encourage our businesses, which I think we'll do. I'm interested in your plan with regard to how to get the recruitment in and how that works. And that's going to be a question that's around the business owners and saying, if you really want to have a vibrant downtown, we need to have a little mix here. And please don't. And I don't know whether we're in a position to do subsidies or help out these other businesses to do it, but it's something we should look at to keep that vibrant downtown. Any other questions? Yes.
I'm curious if you can give an estimation about the ownership of the downtown buildings. Is it spread amongst a variety of landlords, or is it mostly owned by a few?
It's not, I don't want to go into the names, but there are a few that are on a large number of parcels, so they would be that hard tracking them.
Okay. And there's not currently any sort of venue or gathering?
Well, we do. Once a year we get together with regards to the landlords, we give them breakfast, and we talk about what our plans are for the downtown. We are on talk relationships with the landlords for see that group. And that's one of the other large ones, number of stores.
Which one is that?
With regard to farmers' electric centers.
Right. Maybe you shouldn't have raised the rent so high that might have left.
There you go. Yeah.
So that's going to be a really.
That's what, they're one of the factors which are hard. I mean, you can tell they have a lot of money, and they do, but in the end, they're going to have to follow what their business sense is, whether it's their loans or their borrowing or whether what the bank is telling them in terms of what they need to do with their properties.
Tom, do any of the landlords of the commercial properties live in Narbert?
No. They're on
some.
Yeah, they're not. Tom, Jane. Sorry, if I could add to some of the things I've heard and have one comment.
Yeah.
I've heard some great ideas tonight. I totally agree with Karen about anchor stores. I think we need to keep do everything we can to encourage Ripplands to remain. We need to get ready to wash the sands of it and move on. That we already have a handshake or through the development, which I really like that idea too, for a business development group, you know, to have something in place where, that we can, you know, at least have a framework to say, look, we'd like to see that transition happen and recruit someone, if we can, to buy that business and take it over once that's ready to go. Same thing for the family market. I mean, that building's old. I heard Mido, again, now I'm just throwing out rumors, but I heard Mido would look at that space. I heard the building's in really poor shape, so that's where the landlord gets involved. We need to bring them into the conversation of, look, if you want to recruit somebody here, you're going to have to spruce it up a little bit. But also not price it so they're only, you know, a five-star restaurant can be there. So, and I don't know how that conversation happens, but I like that comment a lot. And I've liked a lot about the business development working, recruiting somebody. And then, you know, I'd be willing to say that for me, if we had to create a budget line item to hire somebody part-time to make that their job, I'd be willing to pay that extra $10 or $20 or $50 a year in taxes for that. I don't know how the rest of the residents feel, but I think it's important enough for our downtown that would be a consideration. I'd be willing to give up other things in order to do that.
We talked about that as far as having a downtown manager. Why don't you set aside each year for a downtown manager? It just seemed getting there was really difficult when it's getting the person.
The last two things, I really like the plan for Forest Avenue. I know the devil's in the details, but it could be worked out, you know, whether it's for sale or how much the rent is, who's going to upkeep it, all that stuff has to be worked out. But, you know, that all aside, I love the plan. I love what I saw there. I'm totally in favor of it. If it can be done in 6 weeks, as Bob said, then, you know, by all means, let's have it up and running by December for the holidays. And then the last thing was, and this is totally on a totally different wavelength, there's a strong effort going again for those who care about gerrymandering. And I don't know if council has made a motion as a community to pass a resolution and send it to the powers that be that we would like to see the state legislature make a motion to get rid of or to implement an anti-gerrymandering law and have, you know, there's a whole amount of legislation that's under consideration of people's
sponsoring in regard to
redistribution for the whole state. I'm sorry, for what?
For political reasons.
Correct.
I was about many years ago gerrymandering by the school district, so I'm trying to.
Right, no, I'm talking about from the political lines. Because it can only be done every 10 years. I'm sorry.
The Choctaw district, well, it shouldn't be someone else, but it's totally crazy.
But I think that's something that they're going to be taking up eventually in terms of what our representation is going to be.
Well, there. I went to a website this week, and there's actually, they said, it's a coalition of different groups. League of Women's Voters, for one, and they're looking for boroughs, communities, individuals to write to their legislators, to write to the governor, to try and get this on the agenda and get it passed. Because I think we have 2 years, because it has to come down to a constitutional resolution, it's come down to a referendum for the entire state to vote on, and if we don't do it the next 2 years, then it flips over that won't happen again until the next opportunity, until 2030. And if these things lose momentum, they don't happen in a very tight time frame between the last census and the next census. So if we lose momentum here, we lose all the decade.
Well, I do know our conference coming to town Saturday night at the Legion Hall. So if anyone's interested, I think Jim Nixon has put a couple notices out with regard to it. It's on the community network.
forget the time.
You mean Dwight Evans? He's not our problem. He's the Democratic.
Yes, well.
We don't have a congressman, right?
Well, I don't know.
I didn't, he resigned, right?
Yes.
He resigned.
Yes, we don't have it.
You know, but Dwight will be in town on Saturday, so it's definitely made his life, but actually maybe a good opportunity.
What he's talking about is at the state level, so if you wanted to forward that to the East, so we can, I mean, you know, enough people agree.
Marty, can we ask you as the chair of Economic Development and Borough Council, I don't know if everyone knows that, but would you be willing, since we have you here, that's great, to just say something about how you see an Economic Development Committee moving forward, like working moving forward? So I don't know that anybody here really has a sense of that. I certainly don't.
You mean specifically with the Sally Anderson's proposal?
No, no, just in general. What is the Economic Development Committee and how do you see it functioning?
So the Economic Development Committee, you know.
You're on the spot again, Ryan.
We have the downtown, Howard Third and Dartmouth Avenue, but we also work on the out here. So we, there are two shopping corridors, that you would say. There's a separate subcommittee dealing with the Montgomery Avenue, which is a joint coalition between Lower Marion and Narb, because physically that's what it is, and actually Lower Marion is in charge of most of the line on Montgomery Avenue anyway. So we are hoping to just have a seat at the table and guide some of the discussion going forward. And then we work with Ed, and this committee historically has worked with the Business Association to keep it a revitalized place where people want to shop. When I first came on in January, we actually talked about the idea of, like Mike said, that the state actually funded a position, which Kimberly talked about, and that what was supposed to happen is that the business associations in Pennsylvania were supposed to totally take over the funding of that position.
Yeah.
That never happened.
I know.
In reality, the position is all faded away. We tossed around the idea of a part-time person who would sort of market brand and market Narb so that when there's a potential vacancy down the road, that people who, businesses that would seem to fit with us would be aware and then keep it on their radar as a place to maybe open a business up. I think that it didn't seem like anybody was interested in paying $40,000 to $60,000 for a part-time position. And then there are communities that share a position. So like one person will be half-time in two different places. As long as we're not competing with them, I think that could work out just fine. So I don't think it's a bad idea. I don't know that we don't have the money. The question I think is really what Kimberly, you're saying is, what do we want? And that conversation, so the person who was hired to do that, they have to have a clear idea of what we want to go out and share that with businesses.
And there was a survey done before the downtown project. There may be records somewhere in one of these boxes.
Yeah.
Because it was just that, asking people what they'd like to see. Because I always remember that at the top of the list was an ice cream place. So there you go.
Do you ask for it and you got it.
Yes. What's the
inner
comments? The question is, does the borough own any store or any building that could function as a first floor of the store?
Does
the borough?
Does the borough own any of the commercial property?
Yeah.
Yeah, the borough does not own any property.
The property with a store, not.
No. The borough currently owns the Save Iron property, this building, which is right now, and we control certain parts of the downtown, but there's no funds.
And there is no structure that could be transformed in a store. And I'm telling you where I'm going. I completely agree with some of the comments that there need to be some places, and anchor store and stuff. I use, for example, Family Market every single day sometimes, and I'm right the time when they will retire and,
I think the demand is going to be for that store.
So I'm just thinking,
I truly agree with, and if there is a question of the number putting a price that is too high for that kind of store to survive, if the borough can have a role or try to find a solution so that can subsidize some of the rent or can transform some of the property that they have, so that there would be a mixture of cutesy stores and really stores that serve the community. Because that is the reason why,
for example, I came to Narb. Well, there's a demand. I mean, the American family, there's a demand for that store. Just like there's that same type of store downtown in Philadelphia, right now, Square, whether it be Square Street Market or Red House Market. These little stores are there. You'd be surprised when you walk in and how their goods are laid out, what people look for. And given the changes which we're seeing right now with regards to wine and beer and stores, just means someone could look at that. So I think the demand for like American family markets would be. I don't know whether the borough would be in a position to subsidize the rent to make it competitive for someone to run a store. I think if the store was run, right, it could do very well. I see people coming off the train, I see groups of people, kitchens are like, oh, who's not really cooking when they're buying things and they want to get some food when they come home and take it home with them. Prepared foods or wine.
And I have my comments. And go back to, I'm sorry I came late, but you would think, what is your vision for Narb?
Yes.
And survey is a walking community with store where, that could serve the community and not only attract people from the outside, although that is important too. But it's also kind of trying to save the soul. And you and someone else comment of how bad was to have lost the old 19th century station or whatever it was. I think the borough really, really, really need to find a solution to save the historic building that are here. And I don't think that there is really a need or the sense that this happen if not for few people. And I think it's such a loss to lose all the old building that the borough is losing. And it's a really sad to me. Really, really sad to me.
No, I understand. The spirit, Narb is unique, and you'd be surprised that everyone that comes together, whether it be 4th of July or downtown, it's got that spirit, which has been around for long, so true, which you went to the town 25 years ago. It's love the town. Towns have changed in a certain way and for the better. When 25 years ago, I think Narb was more car-centric too, car prevalent. Now we're more into walking. We're selling ourselves more as a walking pedestrian. We have sidewalks. Every sidewalk leads to downtown. Children today, I go through my kids, they want cars. I have one in Brooklyn, I have one down in Center City, they just don't want to deal with it. But, so you're going to see the lesson of the cars. You don't need as many cars as we have available amenities in downtown. It's all good, and we have to plan accordingly for that. So I'm hoping that the parking study comes out and proves that we can modify, we can change things and worse to our benefit. I agree.
I wonder if you could clarify for people. It's a totally different topic.
So, okay, does anyone have any question about the downtown before we jump on to the next? I don't want to keep you too much.
People have property such as their trees. Other people are not allowed to just arbitrarily come up and cut their trees back because they don't like them in their way. That's illegal. I wonder if you could comment on that.
Well, there's no self-help with regard to it. If the tree itself is actually into the sidewalk area, plus some additional order, then you should contact the police, report the citation will go out. Not the citation, the call will go out. Hey, we need to cut it back. And if it's not cut back, then we need a citation with regard to it. Self-help is not an option with regard to it. We don't handle matters that way.
I have a question.
Yeah.
The tree is 3 foot from yours property, that near your fence, I have the right to cut that, right?
Yeah, you're allowed to trim it, that's all the problem.
Yeah, I don't really want to go there either, but I'm saying.
You don't want to go there, but what I generally recommend is you either talk, have a nice conversation with your neighbor to resolve it and do it by agreement.
Well, we did.
If you feel that, if you just do it on your own, sometimes that causes some really rough interaction with your neighbor.
So take care of the trees that they plant, then you want to get through this.
It's a hard one.
That's why I didn't want to go there.
Whenever I can see where the neighborhood.
No, we do this.
Whatever, so it's always asked for a chance. If it's not done, if it's not done at that point, then it's always good to go call into the borough or contact me. You'd be surprised. I mean, a lot of things we changed with regard to how we handle letters. I've no problem going out to a property to try to work out a resolution so I can get it up. It's definitely an issue. Please have no problem doing that as well. We handle certain kinds of children in the borough that say, it's longer than enough. We should bring parents in and talk to them and try to get some understanding of how it's going on with the child. And there's things we should, which are sort of common sense of some of the dispute resolution rather than the choice. Of course, I agree.
Yes, she's right.
Compromise.
Yes.
Compromise always works with regards to events. When we fail to compromise, it's where we have our problems. That's where we start off with. We don't compromise.
But you forget, you're talking about Anthony Avenue and Iron Avenue that nobody pays attention to anyway. You've got an auto body that parks their cars, you've got paint smells you smell. Got restaurants up there.
But there's good ways to handle that with regard to the
cars.
The cars are going to get ticketed. The cars that go out the street get ticketed. Well, I'm told that I don't do the ticketing.
We can sell 2 hours, but.
Yeah, but it seems like the auto body may be in a position that can pay the tickets and not have to worry about it because the car sees it for a certain number of days. That's part of the auto body. The smells, if you're smelling things from the auto body, you should contact the borough.
I did.
And they will have to contact some other department to make sure that
there's 11 homes on that block. 11 homes. It was 3 of them have moon cars. Then you have the garage that leaves cars out on the weekends. You have about 8 to 9 employees that are parked there every day, plus when they put their beds out, which is nice. I mean, you don't have to come up there and look at it. You know, we do. We pay our taxes like everybody else. It's like a joke. The story of the auto body is nobody knows how it became an auto body. Way back. I've been there for 48 years.
This is an auto body before you
moved in? No. But when we moved in with my husband, it wasn't because his father worked at auto car. And during the war, they stored Jeeps in there. There was two stories. Then all of a sudden, it was an auto body. And nobody knew how it got there. And now this one is third owner.
Well,
but it's...
My understanding about probably the charge.
That's not... I mean, I sit here and listen about the parking down Narb at the center of Narb, but the businesses, you want business to last, so you need to have a parking spot to park your car. Yes, a lot of people do walk. They walk even when I lived here. I worked Castlesford, which has been chasing out for 27 years. The only time I didn't walk is when I worked to 2 o'clock in the morning and I'm not walking anywhere with a uniform on. It shows that I'm a waitress. But it hasn't changed. It still has that friendliness to it. But up that area where we're at, really nobody, it really is a sin. I mean, I know Sean sometimes will take a ride at 10 o'clock at night before he goes home. But she even said, is it like that all the time? I said, no, it's worse. It's worse. If you go to run around the corner and get a quart of milk, because you like the acne milk, you're not even gone 5 minutes, you come home, there's none left. Parking.
I have to second what Bonnie said.
What, honey?
I second what you said. I used to live up on I-100 on the block, and you had to plan when you were going to move your car. because you would never get a spot.
Are there other restaurants taking your spot, or there's a car dealership?
Car dealership, you had apartments on Montgomery Avenue. Every fall, you get the new Villanova students in there, and they said, but we would totally could park on this street. So you get like another five or six cars without a state license plate. I went through this with Bill Martin, and he said, oh, the auto body shop has floating stickers. So because they have all these different cars, so they're floating. That's why they don't have anything there. And so we would call up, complaints, and we'd call and complain, and in about 15, 20 minutes, you'd see people from the auto body shop running out to move the cars before the ticket person got there.
And then we went to 8 o'clock at night.
And right. And that's why I live off the street. It's much better to be away.
And then you have, no offense, you have Woodbine Avenue, who can't park on their street.
Right.
Because they have two restaurants, and then all of a sudden, you have six cars trying to park. Right. But we can tell you the ones that are going to Havana and the ones that are going to Christopher Ryan. Christopher Ryan's going to park there. The ones that go to the Cuban place, whatever it's called. And they can even park in front of the garage. How do they know the park over there?
Has it gotten worse?
Worse is not the word.
Well, I know the car lot is facing a lot of time. I've heard people coming in for a spot to park. I know my question is what's going on in terms of numbers.
For some reason, their customers are completely different than.
A lot of them are from our economy.
Yeah, well, of course we are too, but a lot of them not. They do, like some of the old people, I'm older too, but. They'll say, is it all right? Where are you going to go have a quick dinner? Is it all right? I said, you're fine. At least we know you're going to be out of there in an hour and a half when you have reservations around the corner.
And I remember one time there was a business owner. He owned a piece of place on Sun Valley that is no longer there. And it was a little bit of time in Boston, which makes me more to the bar. And I looked out, and he parked on the street. And he had just had everything cleared in his parking lot. So there were all these spaces there. So I went out and said, excuse me, but we have no other that you took the last space on the street. And I noticed that you've got all these empty spaces in your parking lot. Do you think you could move your car over there? I'm allowed to park here on the street. Aren't I? I'm allowed to park here. I'm going to leave that open for my customers.
I mean, I think unfortunately that's the reality of not having a driveway and moving on a public street. I mean, I live on a street that's completely residential, and if it's winter, somebody has a house guest over, there can be a parking issue.
Right. And there's also no restriction on the number of parking stickers you can get. I had suggested one time that you have like a lottery kind of thing where you only give out X number of parking stickers for a certain area. And everybody could get, initially you could get one or two, and then you put yourself on a waiting list, and the people that have lived there forever like money would be the next to get the parking stickers, so that you can't get, like everybody could get, like five parking stickers for that.
Yeah, but that doesn't apply to Kenwood.
Right.
Kenwood must have about 15, 16. I don't care how long, because it goes from my own to
I agree with her, that area up there, and I think also the Montgomery Avenue Business District has been ignored for decades, and that was one thing. I tried to work with some of the businesses up there to get them to share the parking lots and things, and it was a very frustrating thing, and the common theme was, they don't care about us up here. They think we're all crazy. They don't care about us.
We have a layout.
When you have time,
I understand the buy shop has always been a problem with regard to, and if it requires us to do more enforcement, then we'll go there with regard to, maybe just as simple as contacting Sean, having Sean contact the police during the day and enforcing and taking care of that part. Montgomery Avenue has always been there in terms of when you head across the street, there's so much parking behind state walls. But that's going to be changing as well, because the district justices have moved into
the
city right now, so you can see more, which actually, it's a good thing for us, because you're going to see a lot of police around, like he says, at any given time, and back up and come to the borough and take it. I love that, because they're there.
And then remember when Lou's restaurant had
the trucks
out? They had breakfast and lunch trucks, and so So if I could all come back and they would line up on the street and take those spots.
But there's other parts of parking. I know that the pizza parlor has been shuttered for a long time now. There's probably parking there in the area, isn't there?
Sun Valley Pizza.
If that was your property, would you let it, does anybody park there?
I don't know if it becomes a pressure point that maybe we can do something with regard to the auto body store if it's cars there.
I mean, I tried that kind of stuff with the previous owners and they don't want to pay the money. And it's like, we don't have to do that now, do we? I tried to get them to rent space on the other side of Montgomery Avenue.
I'm surprised because Constance, I know, because the cars are kind of simple sometimes. I picked up a car there.
Well, Constance is good.
Yeah.
But, you know, if it comes down to,
They use the Noble for some wrecks.
And I also want to, like I said, to connect parking lots to make it easier.
With Sun Valley Pizza?
Parking. And their lawyers said, oh, no, we don't want to do that because it increases your liability.
Sun Valley Pizza, they tried to buy that property. Collision Care did.
Uh-huh.
And they wanted to take a sample of something to the ground, and the owner wouldn't let them. But they went about it the wrong way. They should have went down to the borough first and talked to them, and then going to them.
If there's an issue with regard, I'll talk to Sean, who have more police enforcement. Again, something which we should come back and take a look at as far as encourage them. If there are wrecks on the street, I know there are wrecks on the street, we should, if it's really affecting the parking down there, we should find an alternative holding spot for them.
I'm happy now.
There's parking up and down with regard to behind the Royal Bank building. I don't think the Royal Bank building is capable. You know, there's construction down there.
If somebody said to you, you want to spend an extra $1,000 a month to do this, be a nice guy, would you do it?
Well, I don't know. I have to take a look at some of the paying funds by having those cars on the street. It may make sense. It may make good political sense for them to do that by making the business there at the borough. It's hard. You know, we're not in a position where we can get a telecommunication dealers and not operating. That's not going to happen. But if they want to continue to be a good neighbor, then perhaps we can find another place for them to put their cars. And that would alleviate a lot of pressure.
They had one at one time. Do you remember money to buy the house? They had two houses to the right of them on Hampton.
Yeah, the borough said no.
And the borough said no. They were willing to buy those houses, tear them down, and put parking in there. And the borough said that he came to.
Paint the thing. Walkway, but you fence.
Okay.
One of the things I just want to interject is for the Montgomery Avenue development meeting, you should come out to that. One of the concepts that's come up is shared municipal parking behind on both sides, wherever you can, so that people can leave their car, do some shopping, and then not have to move it. That could alleviate some of this, and that would be that kind of shared.
About cars in a different way. There's been a lot of talk online on both Narb sites and about cars. Presenting danger to pedestrians, yes. Going too fast, and so on. And I think it was last week there was an accident that looked pretty bad on South Narberth Avenue around Woodside. I don't know what the circumstances were, but we're by that Elmwood corner, which is already a very difficult corner, and it's going to get more difficult with the apartment building going up. And you have a visibility issue that I understand is going to be a little better, but still pretty much the same. But on the other side, there's the little gym and there's the ballet school. And people routinely double park to move their kids up. And it makes everything more dangerous, that stretch of North Harbor and South Harbor. And that seems like something that can be enforced to me. You know, if the police show up sometimes, people may realize that can't do the same.
There's two alternatives with regard to that. One is, if you do see a car double parked in the street, call the non-emergency number with regard to it, and a police officer will come out. If they're there in the area, they'll take care of it. Sometimes you don't want to wait around, whatever occurs.
you can take down the plate number. Now, and I've mentioned this before with regard to cars that go through, you know, there's a stop sign, and cars going through the stop signs not stopping. If you see cars that there's a bus involved and not stopping for the bus stop, give me the plate. We'll get a letter from the mayor telling them that we've seen them, we're knowing what they're doing, and we're going to call them accountable for it. Okay?
It's so constant. Location.
Well,
like it was bad with ballet school,
but with that, and we were up there a number of times, and it's been a recurring problem. People tend to think that they can double park there, waiting for the children to come out of the ballet. They do it. You know, and every year brings a new crop of students and a new crop of cars. And what we'll do is we will send a police cruiser around, tell them to move on. I don't want the police cruiser to sit there. I mean, part of the beauty of Narb and what I try to do with the police cruisers is to keep them moving. That keeps bad people away when they see police cars running from neighbors. I can't have them sit in one location.
No, I'm not suggesting I'm suggesting at certain times of day when it's much worse, that maybe that's part of the cruising around.
Give me a plate. The plate numbers are easily traceable. Our sergeant will send a letter off. I'll send a letter off. And you're saying if you're talking about doing it anymore, and they can notice.
I
think if you get a letter from the borough saying, you know, you're sitting there, we'll stop. And that gets out there. Same thing with regard to the most egregious is going through a stop or a bus stop. That's horrible. But if you see that happening, give us the plate number. We may ask that you do a sworn statement, and we can use that sworn statement to prosecute them in court so they don't do it again. That's all we can do. So police, we have a wonderful police department. They do constant patrols. They're there, call them, and be your doorstop to help you. But they can't be everywhere at every corner, any location, at any time. And you see a lot of my favorites. And I do watch the threads coming through the Narb thread and the Narb community thread and try to answer them. I don't want to engage people with policy issues on those sites, but I do watch them, and then I do report to our sergeant what to do, what kind of hands on that. But part of it is community participation. You can help us. You can give us a plate, and we'll go after them, and they will not do it again. Now, please, once they get that letter, they stop.
Yeah, and I have to double park behind me.
And I tell them, I've had this interaction before. I mean, the fastest thing you do is everyone has cell phones. You can snap a picture of the plate, and at least it will be played, and recall the plate. You don't want the picture for court, but at least we'll play it. It's a Pennsylvania plate, and the 6 or 7 digits which are associated with it. And everyone has my cell number. I can make it more easier, 267-934-1750. You do is you text me the picture, and we'll get it picked up right now.
That area
on
South Narberth Avenue, where that accident occurred, somebody ran a stop sign, which is what happened.
But there was a tree,
and you can't see too well there. But is there any possibility of getting a stop sign on
Roosevelt
just to slow down the...
There's possibility for stop signs at all locations. We have been more restricted in years past with regards to stop signs requesting warrants for them, which could be either an accident history or speeding history with regard to stop signs. But things have changed with regard to our position as storm warnings with regard to how they do stop signs. If you feel that there's a need for a stop sign, please send me the request, and I'll take it out of the Public Safety Committee or the Borough Council and we'll move on. So there's certain spots in the borough that you look at and say, my God, there should be a stop sign here. And if it actually helps slow or modify or help make
areas safer. Slow things down coming up to that bridge area, you know, which is such a congested, dangerous part. So also, I had asked once about speed bumps, and I was told by Bob Weisbord that we're not allowed to have speed bumps.
Well, the speed bumps, they can lift you off and go off, and that's what we've seen.
Well, I don't mean on North Narb, but I just wondered, in general, in the borough, we're not allowed
to. Well, people are around. I think PennDOT, there's a couple of issues with regard to PennDOT's approval of speed bumps. Part of it is the vehicle itself, you lose speed, you lose control, you lose speed bump, you lose speed, and how like that. Number two is the car from the reason makes you're hitting it. Imagine if you live across the street from the speed bump, or you even hear a little. And that's going to be a whole issue, a sound issue with regard to the.
Because I drive through suburbs sometimes and they have kind of gentle speed bumps, and I'm looking at
the. There's one gradual.
Right, though it's not like these bumps, but there's a gradual one, and I think when people get used to the idea that there's a speed bump, then they might be more apt to go 25 rather than 30.
I think on South Park, I don't know what it is.
Yeah, Essex has the same issue because there's no stop sign, and people tend to kind of pick up speed there, and it's so many children there.
In conjunction with talking about the downtown area, do you think the speed limit in the downtown blocks could be reduced? So I think 25 might be slightly too fast, especially since people just don't seem to be able to stop.
Do you see people going 25 in the downtown?
But they go through the crosswalks.
Crosswalks have to be addressed.
Could it be like 15 for a couple blocks? You know, could it be that low? Because then people would really, I think, stop for the crosswalks. And if we do these things with those two, like the circle and the gas station area, there's going to be a lot of traffic going across the street, and we want that, you know, so.
I can address it in our side. I do know the problem a lot of times is trying to gauge how fast the car is going. Because you need the beginning part and the end part and determine how fast they're traveling, whether that's really enforceable. And I have to check the statute regard. I'm not sure we can pump traffic down to 50 miles per hour on any occasion. I know there's got to be reasons such as our parks or school zones, but I'm not sure whether transit areas are going to do the head-on regulations.
Just park the school bus there all the time
with the sign up. It'd be surprising. The downtown has its own common area with regard to vehicles of both sides. We can do a better job with regard to, and I'm surprised we haven't hit that point with regard to our crosswalks. Because you can really use some creative crosswalks in terms of designs.
And the cars can't always see. Because the cars are parked, and then people are standing here to cross. And you actually can't see the people unless they're really like out in the street. So it's hard for the cars to even know. And then they'll kind of go at a regular speed, and all of a sudden they're like, oh, there's a person there, but it's not too late.
And there's a distraction factor as well. I mean, I'm looking at it. I mean, the park is wonderful, and the stores are beautiful, and the bars are there. And you're looking at 30 different places at one time, and not necessarily at the pedestrians. And that's always, it's always not true. But we can do a better job with regards to the demarcation points, with regards to those walkways. We should do something where we can do the design.
Dancing clowns.
I mean, is there anything we can do to expedite that? Because I know that was something we talked
public
about
works.
I
mean, public,
a year ago.
Well, yeah. The public works did a lot of training with regard to it. So.
I mean, I just know, like with the tactical urbanism movement, my husband could go out there tonight with a stencil and spray paint and like. I mean, I'm just saying, like with the parklet. Bill and I were like, we want to do this. We took our own money and we did it because we wanted to start a conversation about how we envision downtown, how we can shift the conversation back to re-envisioning Station Circle or whatever our vision is for Narberth. And I feel like whether you like the parklet or not, it was effective in recharging that conversation, which is really exciting. But like with the crosswalks, I mean, seriously, we could get out there and like make a community event out of it, even like bring in some artists or whatever, and just
we have the pink crews. I do know they did some quarters. I mean, I did see them this summer.
The money was budgeted for. Sean has it all ready to go, and there was supposed to be something with the weather. I don't know why they ended up not doing it at all. But there was initially I brought it up in economic development, and it went to public works and. In that committee, we discussed whether we should do something fancy or Narberth-y for those crosswalks that really stand out, or whether it should just be like white lines or whatever. Ultimately, Sean came bought the paint and we own it, and there's a machine that can do it, and I have no idea why.
It's a final edition.
It
there really is a final edition with regard to.
And also, Pico's going to be doing. There is going to be some road pairing up next year, I think it was.
Next year for us.
So whatever we do shouldn't cost us too much money because we can do it over again. But I think there is almost. it's impossible to see from a car point of view. If you're just driving along, you can't see where the crosswalks are, let alone that people cross, you know, sometimes where they want to cross.
I know Bob Goldberg was here earlier, and he did take a dinner with regards, so I'll make sure he follows up with Public Works.
Yeah, no, some of the things that are supposed to be out there to alert people that this is a crosswalk, and I brought this up before, are often pushed back against the curb. They're heavy and they're awkward. Many times I called them back out where they're supposed to be. I asked if it was the responsibility of the borough crew to do that. The answer was yes, and I have no idea whether they're doing it. But it's not that big a deal. They're cruising around town in big trucks anyway. Just stop and pull those things out where people can see them. If they're placed right, they are visible, so at least it helps.
But they're not stop signs, and people aren't required to stop at a crosswalk unless it's a person waiting to cross. And that's hard to see those people when you're in a car.
We do need to get the crosswalks painted, but I agree with regard to the problem. I do the same thing on Windsor and Firewalk property of the park. You know, I always have to point it out. It seems like they get pushed off to the side during storms and street cleanings. And for some reason, they're not getting back out of the cab and pointing back toward the shipping. And if you see those cross, those little yellow signs, put them out. Put them out as far as you want. It's fine with me. You know, as long as it's out there. People have to go a little bit slower because they're seeing it.
But the people with little kids and strollers and stuff shouldn't have to do that. If it's part of the borough crew's job, it should be happening.
How expensive would be the one there is one in Lancaster Avenue, there are a few around 10. The lights up, right? So it's something is high, it's visible, and I don't think it would cost a lot of money.
That would be a perfect location for that as well. You know, because of, like I said, all the other distractions that you're driving down the street, really makes you focus on the crosswalk.
Well, I think the street sweeper, what we've noticed, because we're out a lot early in the morning with a one-year-old and a four-year-old, the street sweepers are the ones that I've noticed typically move them off to the side, and then they just don't make their way back.
Yeah, so I'm going to follow up with Sean, right with the bikes, and make a concerted effort to get them to move back. But we really need to get the word out, so that's something that should be done. And you're right, we have the money, we have the resources. I just don't have a good explanation.
You putting all this down on the list, Tom?
Yeah. I say nice conversation, Sean.
You mean painting it? Think they didn't paint it at the beginning of the school year? Of course,
well, they did. But I do know they were out, and I saw them because they drive around. But I don't know why they didn't fill the areas they should have been.
Didn't you say, Margaret, say they didn't do our corner where the buses? Because I even asked Sean, I said, are you aware the school starts in 3 days and there's none of these are painted? So where did they paint?
I do
one south side for Rock
Windsor. They do see parts of it. I know Windsor saw some of that. I don't know.
I think it's the first time since I lived here that they were never painted.
It should have been done. It should have been done here. I don't know what the reason is. I'll talk to Sean about it and see why. But it's again, it's something that we can usually address.
I've seen those signs that say they're smaller, but they say PA State law requires you to stop for pedestrians. Those are you know, very serious looking, and you know the kid looking ones, the fluorescent ones. You see those, but when you also see the PA State law ones, I don't know how much it would be to get a couple of those to put right in the center, because then people are going to take note that it's not like optional.
Okay.
I like the ones that flash.
You shoot fireworks off.
And you know, the batteries don't use electricity. It's all done by sun, and then at night they, you find them all over.
We'll find a solution for it, like I said. We'll follow up. That's
something that's just in the garbage. Don't
cheat and stop by. We have like an arbor that goes over here, and when somebody's in the crosswalk, they push the button, and a little blinking lights go off. I mean, that's much more.
Fireworks, shoot fireworks. We're good at fireworks.
That scares the animals.
Everyone, any questions? Well, thank you, everyone, for coming out tonight. I'm going to continue. We spent a lot of time in the downtown. I'm going to schedule another one, because I do want to get to other areas, such as the bias swell and what our communities are like. So, I think I'm going to October and November, we'll get on schedule so we can continue the conversation. conversation. Okay, but thank you, everyone.